Today, jurors started hearing testimony in James Worley's capital murder trial.
And coming from that testimony, a bloody motorcycle helmet appears to have led police closer to Worley. 13ABC's Sean Hegarty tracking the case. He's live with why prosecutors say Worley had to kill the UT student. Sean?
Yeah, Diane, according to prosecutors, they say after Joughin was kidnapped, they believe Worley had to cover his tracks. They believe there was too much evidence left inside his barn linking him to the disappearance, and that's why they believe she was killed. In opening statements, prosecutors said today that Sierah's DNA was found on rope, duct tape, and paper towels inside a barn at Worley's home. Prosecutors allege that Worley kidnapped Joughin off her bike on County Road 6 in July of 2016. They found, say, blood found in the fields also matches Joughin's, and Worley's DNA can be found on her bicycle. Worley said in a recorded police interview at the scene that he was there because his motorcycle had broken down. He spotted a bike, picked it up, debated riding it home, but instead tried to get the motorcycle up and running. He says he eventually did get it working long enough to get home. But prosecutors say Worley was really attacking Joughin at the time. She had blunt force trauma to the head consistent with being hit with a motorcycle helmet. Police recovered that motorcycle helmet a few days earlier and confronted Worley about it in a second conversation. Here's part of it.
Let's talk to him about the helmet.
What about the helmet? You found the helmet?
Yes.
Okay, where's the helmet at? Who had it?
Who had it? Along the road.
You found it along the road?
I didn't find it. Someone did.
Well, bring it on here, because I want my helmet back.
Well, that's why we're here, mostly, is because the helmet looks like it might have some blood on it.
No.
Now, so far, the defense has not cross-examined many of the witnesses, many of those witnesses setting up a timeline for the night Sierah disappeared. In its opening statement, the defense only told jurors to carefully look at all of the expected 400 exhibits.
We feel that after reviewing all of the exhibits, after hearing the testimony that's put before you, and following the law as it will be given to you by Judge Robinson at the close of this case, we feel that you can come to but one conclusion, and that is that the state of Ohio has not proven each and every essential element beyond a reasonable doubt, and you must make but one finding, and that is findings of not guilty.
One of the questions that was raised today when they were talking about the motorcycle incident broken down, why, if the motorcycle had broken down, was he wandering out into a cornfield where he says he found Sierah's bicycle? Well, the answer to investigators was that he didn't want anyone on the road to see he was trying to repair his motorcycle.
Did you know Sierah Joughin?
Yes.
And how did you know her?
She was my girlfriend.
And how long had you known her?
Since I was 6.
What was your status with Sierah on July 19, 2016?
We were dating at that time for about 7 years. It was just coming up to 7 years.
I would like for you to describe your activities on July 19, 2016.
I was at work and was on my way home, and me and my friend Nick were going to work on a table that we were building in my garage. And I got home and Nick wasn't there yet, so I figured I'd start on the table. I was there working on the table, and she showed up.
And did she arrive on bicycle?
Yeah.
How far is it between your residence and where Sierah lives?
Around 6 miles, give or take. I continued working on the table.
Mr. Kolesinski, would you like a drink of water?
Yeah.
Could we get some water?
She showed up and I continued working on the table, and she left and I followed her.
On your motorcycle?
Yes. We got a few miles down the road and she told me that, you know, she was yelling at me that she didn't need me by her side and that she was fine. And we were at a corner, and I gave her a kiss and said bye.
And when you split, where did you go?
I went back home.
And your knowledge would Sierah continue on to the east?
Yes.
Those accurately depict the videos that you took on your ride with Sierah on July 19, 2016?
Yes.
Move your ass away from me! Reggie, I want those nuggets now! I'm going out of the library! Move your ass!
I texted C and just, I believe I said, are you home? It was probably 8, 9 o'clock, and I was getting in bed, and I sent a few more texts, and I didn't get a response. So I ended up texting her grandma, which is, she lived at her grandma's house, and she said that she thought she was with me. And so I texted her mom, and her mom said that she wasn't home. And once I got that, I was texting her grandma again, and her grandma said that her bike wasn't there. So right when I saw that, I got out of bed and went straight to Sheila's house.
Sheila would be Sierra's mother?
Yes.
During your time with Sierra, did you ever see her wear any clothing that resembled that?
No.
Prior to July 19th of 2016, did you know the defendant? Did you know him personally?
No.
To your knowledge, did Sierra know him?
No.
Any reason she would know him?
No.
Any reason that she would be over at his residence, to your knowledge?
No.
Sir, I have to ask, did you have anything to do with Sierra's death or disappearance?
No.
No cross-examination, witness, Your Honor.
Witness is excused.
I did notice that her light wasn't on, which now strikes me as very odd, but I thought, well, you know, she might have been tired from the bike ride. I didn't know if she had to get up early and she was going to go work out, or if she had to work early.
Members of the Fulton County Sheriff's Office, along with investigators from the Bureau of Criminal Investigation, testified to finding a cornfield Sierah was abducted from, showing the jury blood-stained evidence they collected, like Sierra's sock and bike. The jury then learned it was a volunteer member of a search team who found Sierra's grave in another cornfield. And images of how Sierra was found in that grave brought a BCI investigator to tears.
And she's got straw in her hair. She's got a brassiere, like a lace-covered brassiere, handcuffs, a rope, and an adult diaper.
That adult diaper, along with other items found in Sierra's grave, the state then worked to link back to Worley. Investigators testified to finding similar items like those diapers, tube socks, lacy undergarments, and bondage items in a green tub in one of Worley's barns.
Some large zip ties, and it appears to be a ball gag.
Each day we're hearing more and more about the small little details investigators have been looking for. Sometimes it means they've been digging on their hands and knees during a week in which the temperature soared into the 90s. I'll show an example of some of the detail when it comes to Worley himself. Investigators took these photos of Worley when he was taken into custody around the time when Joughin's body was found in a Fulton County cornfield. Investigators noticed several small cuts and took photographs to document them. Now, to be clear, we have not been told yet how those cuts got there, if they play any role in this case. Detail like that even continued when investigators found the hole where Joughin's body was found. It's being described as somewhere between 4 and 6 feet deep. When investigators determined they had located the actual body, they put their shovels away and sometimes literally dug by hand.
It becomes a very slow process. It becomes almost like an archaeological dig. We'll use like trowels and dustpans and our hands, but no longer do we use shovels, paintbrushes, that type of thing.
Some of the evidence seen today by the jury was pretty disturbing.
Yeah, it certainly was. We'll get to that in just a second, but I was going to tell you about the prosecution submitting evidence that they say was found by investigators on a barn located on James Worley's property. They also submitted evidence, and the jurors were able to see this evidence and hear witness testimony in connection to this evidence that was found on Sierah Joughin's lifeless body. Overall, the testimony today was pretty procedural as well as descriptive, and it came from male and female investigators. But then there was the evidence of rope, a key to handcuffs, and a sock Sierah was allegedly wearing when she was discovered.
I have step tape, so I'm going to step tape around her ankles. She's in the hot tight position.
The prosecutor continues to lay out the evidence in this case, but we have yet to hear if any DNA evidence links Worley to the murder. Jurors hearing the James Worley case were shown the inside of Worley's workshop, a black muddy boot collected by investigators, and a shovel found by a farmer. The farmer did not want to show his face.
In 2016, when we finished the field, I was walking back to the truck and I stepped on a shovel that was alongside the road.
The farmer testified he took the shovel back to his barn and put it in a recycling bin. He told the court he kept it for a week before telling law enforcement. The prosecution has not said if it's the same shovel used to bury Sierah Joughin in a grave.
You stated that
we can't show you her face, but Worley's attorney questioned a BCI agent about whether the boots collected were tested.
Now, was that mud or dirt collected for submission to any laboratory?
I do not know whether or not that dirt or not was collected. It was collected and preserved, as you see here. Whether or not there was further testing done, I am not aware of that.
The defense also asked the BCI agent if blood was found on Worley's motorcycle.
In processing that motorcycle, you used an agent which you used to determine whether or not there's blood on it. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And you put that agent on that motorcycle. Is that correct?
That's also correct.
And there was no finding presumptive for blood on the motorcycle. Is that correct?
Correct.
They also testified that they found guns in Worley's home. Now, Worley was not supposed to have any weapons because he's a convicted felon.
Well, defense lawyers today tried to poke holes in the prosecution's scientific evidence in the murder trial of Sierah Joughin. That includes revelations of a major mix-up by investigators.
DNA sample admitted to the state crime lab wasn't what anyone expected.
This specific incident is all about the brother of James Worley. His name is Mark. Now, the crime lab had submitted his DNA sample as a standard as they tested items related to the case. The only problem was when the state crime lab tested the standard, that standard turned out to be a female. So it was no good. In fact, it's not clear who that sample belongs to. Defense lawyers have been questioning all the DNA evidence that was introduced, especially the stuff today. Some of that includes a motorcycle helmet found where Sierra's bike was found on the night she disappeared. DNA evidence showed the presence of Worley's DNA and Joughin's DNA. What defense lawyers brought up today is there's no way for the analysts to determine when the DNA got there. All they can say is that it's there.
You cannot tell when that human blood was deposited on that helmet, is that correct?
That's correct.
And you cannot tell the location, the physical location of where the blood was deposited on the helmet, is that correct? You can't say it happened at this site or it happened over here at a physical location, someone's address or the street or anything, is that correct?
That's correct.
That's one of the crime lab analysts there responding to those answers from the defense lawyer. Now, Joughin's boyfriend has testified that Sierah had never had contact with Worley and didn't believe the two knew each other. Also today, an FBI expert on cell phones testified that Joughin and Worley were in the same general area at the same time on the night she disappeared.
Disturbing testimony this morning in the trial of the People versus James Worley. The coroner who performed Sierah Joughin's autopsy took the stand.
First thing this morning, the judge did warn the jury to let them know that what they are about to hear and see was going to be very graphic and could be disturbing to them. That same warning was also given to Sierah Joughin's family, who has been inside the courtroom for this entire trial. Many of them did take the judge's warning and they left for that testimony. Now, Dr. Cynthia Beiser, Lucas County Deputy Coroner, not only described the condition of Sierah Joughin's body, but also showed the jury pictures of Sierah the way she looked when she arrived at the coroner's office. Dr. Beiser explained that Sierah did have two injuries to her head, and despite one of the fractures being severe, the coroner said they did not contribute to her death. Dr. Beiser explained it was a yellow dog toy placed in Sierra's mouth, secured with rope that acted as a ball gag that ended her life. The coroner explained the yellow object was the same size as the inside of Sierra's mouth, and she simply couldn't breathe.
What was your opinion at the time of Ms. Garber's death?
She died of asphyxia due to manual obstruction of the mouth.
Now, something else that Dr. Cynthia Beiser did testify to, she was asked if Sierah Joughin was raped or sexually assaulted, and she said after performing that autopsy, there were no signs of any sexual abuse.
After a week of seeing evidence on Friday, jurors learned items that were found at the scene where police say Sierah went missing did contain Worley's DNA, and that Sierah's DNA and blood was found on items at Worley's property.
What did you find as to this air mattress that was presumptive positive for blood?
On the sample collected from the air mattress, I obtained a mixture. Sierah Joughin was included as a major contributor. And the statistic associated with that was rarer than 1 in 1 trillion. And James Worley was excluded as the major contributor.
Though throughout the state's presentation of their evidence and witnesses, Worley's defense team worked to cast a shadow of doubt in the jurors' minds that Worley was not the killer, including when Worley's attorney pointed out that DNA from a man was found underneath Sierah Joughin's fingernails, but was not the defendant's.
An unknown male sufficient for comparison. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Mr. James Worley, Mr. Joshua Kolosinski, Mr. Jackson Vandenbush, and Mr. Thomas Joughin are all excluded. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Today, the state called witnesses to the stand who used technology and science to help prove their case. First, a member of the FBI who analyzed James Worley's flip phone data, as well as Sierah Joughin's smartphone data. His analysis showed that their phones were near each other the night Sierah went missing for over an hour.
These phones were in the general area of each other. Remember, the spreadsheets don't tell me exactly where the phone is. It's in these general areas. These phones on different networks were in the same general area at the same general time.
Also to take the stand today, an investigator for Ohio's Bureau of Criminal Investigation. She was responsible for testing several items police collected from Worley's property and the farm field where Sierah went missing, as well as the one her body was found. She looked for blood and semen. Several of the items police submitted did test positive for bodily fluids.
A woman attacked by Worley back in the 90s, telling her story to the jury this morning.
And this was the last witness for the prosecution.
The story told today has no direct connection with Joughin's murder. In fact, Sierah Joughin was not even born when this attack happened. That witness today is Robin Gardner. She says in July of 1990, she was approached by James Worley close to her home in White House. She was riding her bike when Worley approached her in his car. Here's how she describes what happened next.
And I was in the truck at that time, and he was standing on the street, and he put handcuffs on my right wrist, and I didn't want him to get both hands behind my back, so I held onto the steering wheel with my left hand. And we fought and fought to get, he wanted to get both hands behind my back, and I fought and fought and fought. So I finally saw a person coming eastbound. I could see them through the car window. And I was struggling as much as I could so that he could see that I was in distress. Well, he let go of me.
So what happened then?
And then the door closed on the passenger side, and I slid across the seat. And the driver's side door was still open, and I ran out into the street.
What injury did you sustain?
When I got to the hospital, they x-rayed everything, and I had a skull fracture and a concussion.
And prior to July 4th of 1990, had you ever met the defendant, James Worley?
No.
Law enforcement arrived at your home, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then they transported you back to the scene.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
And at the scene, at that time, was Mr. Worley, is that correct?
Yes.
He did not flee the scene between your encounter and when law enforcement arrived. Is that correct?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. He remained at all times on the scene.
Yes.
You do not.
Yes.
After the state rested earlier this week, the defense had a chance to present their case today. They called two witnesses who didn't want to be on camera, but the men were both longtime friends of James Worley. They both testified about Worley's motorcycle. The state is trying to prove it was Worley on his motorcycle who ran Sierah Joughin off the road. The defense is trying to prove to the jury that Worley's motorcycle was old and unreliable and broke down in the same cornfield where police believe Sierah was abducted from.
Once he got the motorcycle started and he was driving down the road, it wouldn't stall. Is that accurate? It always stalled when he stopped?
Basically, we slow down and sometimes it would stop.
Okay, and when it would stall, how long would it be stalled for?
Usually till you give it another kick start. Yeah.
The defense also submitted one piece of evidence, a DVD with a full browser history from Worley's computer. In the state's case, they focused on porn sites Worley visited. The defense told the jury there was more than just porn on his computer.
We've told you about lingerie and bondage paraphernalia that were found inside Worley's barn by investigators. Today, a bit of an explanation of why it was there, coming from someone who says he has spent time in that barn and did so well before Sierah disappeared.
Since we first showed you this barn in 2016, it's always looked like your typical barn, but now we have at least an idea of what was going on inside.
He mentioned something about building a little studio in the back corner of it or something.
A studio, according to this neighbor and Worley friend, to produce pornography.
Yeah, I don't know. It was just talk.
It was talk.
Right. I didn't really pay that much attention to it.
The man also testified that he and Worley would watch pornography inside the home as Worley used a nanny cam to monitor his mother. Now, back in the barn.
When you were in the barn, did you ever smoke marijuana with Mr. Worley?
Sure.
How often would you smoke marijuana?
Every time I went over there.
Every time you went over?
Yes, sir.
That was about once or twice a month, according to the witness. Now, this is all coming after the state crime lab investigator Wednesday morning testified to finding bondage apparatus and women's lingerie.
He said that if he got some girl to come out there to visit him, he could maybe tear it or something, and it wouldn't be tearing something that she owned.
Both the prosecution and the defense spoke to the jurors today, and both sides talked about the evidence in this case.
Prosecutors say all the evidence paints a picture, putting two people together who'd never met before and ending with a brutal crime. The defense, though, says take a closer look at the evidence and it shows quite a few holes in what they say is reasonable doubt. So what did happen to Sierah Joughin on that July night in 2016? Prosecutors say James Worley was watching pornography for several hours that day, left his home on his motorcycle and came across Joughin riding her bike, hit her with his helmet, and brought her back to his barn 3 days later. Her body was found in a cornfield. Prosecutors reminded the jury that Joughin's DNA was found on Worley's helmet, inside his barn on duct tape and an air mattress, and phone records placed two of them close to each other that night. The defense, though, is countering, saying Worley's DNA is not found on Joughin's body. They also pointed out that DNA under Joughin's fingernails matches an unknown male, not Worley. So today, the push to push toward what's there and not there.
The evidence left you a trail to follow from County Road 6 to the North Barn to the burial site where Sierah and defendant's DNA is found at all three locations, among other evidence.
What is not found on Miss Joughin's body, what is not found on the dog toy, what is not found on the handcuffs, what is not found on the bindings, James Worley's DNA. It's not there, ladies and gentlemen. Not at all.
So now we wait to see how long the jury will deliberate tonight.
We, the jury impaneled in the above entitled action, having been sworn well and truly to try and true deliverance to make between the state of Ohio and the defendant James Worley, and having been fully advised in the premises, for our verdict find and say that we find the defendant guilty of the offense of aggravated murder.
Our hope through this painful process was to find justice for Sierah. Justice for her abduction and murder, justice for our family, and justice for the amazing community that so many of us live in. I want to express to you how pleased we are that justice has been served today and this murderer was found guilty on all counts.
A damaged man, that is how his own lawyers are describing James Worley today.
Testimony finally getting underway this morning, the sentencing or the penalty phase of Worley's trial. He was convicted, of course, of killing Sierah Joughin.
Some witnesses took to the stand to describe what they described as his past bizarre behavior. Others offered testimony in support of him.
Let's check in with 13 ABC's Sean Haggerty live with what happened today.
And this is the phase where we learn more about Worley himself and his past bizarre actions that led those defense lawyers to call him a damaged man today. Worley is literally fighting for his life. He faces the death penalty for killing Sierah Joughin in 2016 in Fulton County. Today, his lawyers described him as an odd fellow. We heard testimony from his sister about how he'd sit in a puddle as a child and scream. He's been tested and came back to say he had average intelligence. What was interesting to the defense hired investigator was that Worley has a college education and what appears to be a decent background. He even got support from people as this case developed.
It was a somewhat strange, based on my prior experiences, that people in the community thought very highly of James Dean Worley. I had a number of letters on his behalf who came to his defense. And like I said, I never had that happen before in any cases I worked on. I worked on about 50-plus cases.
The man convicted of killing Sierah Joughin killed before?
And that possibility brought up today in court as his defense team tries to keep him off of death row.
The instance that we're hearing about now is something we've not heard about before. Worley suspected, although never charged, with killing a prostitute in 2000. This in today's first day of testimony in the penalty phase. James Worley could face the death penalty. He could also get life without parole or life with parole after 25 or 30 years. Was this the first time he's killed someone? Today, we heard a recorded conversation between a defense-hired investigator and Worley's sister in Los Angeles. The investigator mentions that Worley was suspected of killing a prostitute in 2000 in this area, but never charged.
2000. Prostitute. He was supposed to...
Just wrapping up now in the People versus James Worley. Earlier today, a surprising request by one of James Worley's attorneys. Today in the sentencing portion, many in the courtroom just taken aback by what he asked the jury to do.
Mark Brilling told the jury that he is a father himself of three children, and despite the four sentencing options, he hopes that the jury only considers the two harshest penalties. With the death penalty on the table as one of the possible punishments for the murder of Sierah Joughin, James Worley's attorney asked the jury for mercy.
I would ask for life imprisonment without the possibility of parole and to allow him to die in prison.
Though the prosecution did not shy away from asking for the maximum punishment.
If the jury unanimously determines that the aggravating circumstance outweighs the mitigating factors, there can be but one sentence. You must find. You must find that the death penalty be imposed.
Today, the jury heard about Worley's past, his childhood, upbringing, and adult life, giving the jury insight into what could have possibly caused him to kill Sierah.
You're going to hear that he was an odd fellow, kind of a weirdo, most of his life. And we've all known people like that, who are a little weird, a little odd, people you don't really want to be around, or they're just goofy.
Something else to note, before court did get in session today, Sierah Joughin's mother took to Facebook and she told everybody on her daughter's Justice for Sierah Facebook page that justice has already been served for her daughter, and that if James Worley does receive life in prison without parole, that is still an acceptable punishment for her and her family.
She says, look, baby, I'm a rock star. You won't see her in my pickup. Grabs my own. She's gotta have that radio. Clean it up, say, bless her heart, she can't sit still. Hit him on TV. Feet on the can't see the ball game. Just come on, so baby, just lay my life around and say, you rock on, baby. Now, honey, it's a stick. She wants you. Remember what you did last time.
She can't win. That's my baby.
She's my kind.